Coronavirus is a virus primarily of animal origin. It resides and infects animals. However, it can be transmitted from animals to humans and thereafter spread from persons to persons. COVID-19 coronavirus is a new strain of the coronavirus that is currently infecting humans worldwide. The statistics to date are increasing and alarming. The symptoms of coronavirus could be mild, severe, or critical. I must say that to date, there are no vaccines to prevent the COVID-19. However, there are several simple, regular measures we can take to prevent the infection. One of such is to regularly wash our hands with liquid soap under running water. In the absence of that, we could regularly apply alcohol-based hand sanitizers to our hands. We should also follow the principle of social distancing, meaning we should keep about 3 feet away from one another. If you are coughing, cough into the bent elbow rather than the hands. Also, avoid touching the eyes, the nose, and the mouth with the hand, especially if they are not clean. Avoid shaking of hands. You can use other means of greetings like a wave, a bow, and other means. Avoid contact with people that are sick. If you are sick, you have symptoms that suggest that you may have COVID-19 infection, fever, cough, difficulty with breathing, and other symptoms, avoid public places. Don't go to work. Don't go to school. Seek medical assistance. Clean surfaces that you touch regularly. The door, knob, and other surfaces you touch regularly. Food and animal organs. I'll say from the outset, contacting COVID-19 infection is not a death sentence in all cases. 80% of persons that have contacted it will have mild symptoms and will recover fully from it. The challenge is in the remaining 20% of persons who might require hospital admission because of severe and critical symptoms. The chances of survival is slimmer, but is still good, provided there are no chronic medical conditions in the persons, such as hypertension, diabetes, cancers, and other debilitating illnesses, whose bodies may not be able to mount a viral infection. Remember, our safety is our collective responsibility. So, stay positive, stay safe, and stay healthy.
So Lord, I welcome you to our leaders development session, and I pray that the Lord himself will open our eyes to see wonderful things out of his word that will benefit our lives, you, myself, our congregations, and everyone that we minister to. Once again, I appreciate your coming and your faithfulness. The Lord bless you. Let's pray together. Father, we bless your name for this session of looking at your word as your ministers. Lord, I'm asking that your spirit will open our eyes and make us see and behold wonderful things out of your word in Jesus' name. Enrich the lives of your ministers, the lives of your servants, brothers and sisters. And I pray, Lord, the enrichment, the enlightenment will make us to go forward, be proactive, and then be productive in the work of the Lord more than ever before in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. Today we're coming to a very familiar passage, and it's Psalm 1 from verse 1 to verse 6. Psalm 1, verse 1, all through to verse 6. Let's look at it together. Verse 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. In verse 2 it says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. In his law does he meditate day and night. Verse 3, it says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Now verse 4 gives us the contrast. It says, the ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. In verse 5, it says, therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. The final verse now, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. As you look at that verse 1, it says in verse 1, blessed is the man. Blessed is the man. Actually, in the original, the authorities have told us, it says, blessed is that man. So this is not a faceless man. This is not just a man hanging in the air that we cannot locate, we cannot identify. Blessed is the man. From what it says in the whole psalm, we can tell this is a man, number one, a man of God. A man of God in the sense that he is not unrighteous, he is not ungodly, he is not a sinner, he is not scornful. He has separated himself from the people that are of the world. What would you say about such a man? It's a saved man. We want to go beyond that. This is a sanctified man. This is a man who has set himself apart. And he will not walk, he will not stand, he will not sit in the seat of the scornful. The counsel he takes and the way he follows is the way of the Lord, and the counsel of the Lord. We'll say it's a principled man. It's a man who has made up his mind, this is the way I'm going to walk, and this is the place I'm going to stand, and this is the seat I'm going to sit on. His life is organized. His life is productive. He's meditating on the word of God, and he's doing something. He's doing something. And what he does, the word of God says, will prosper. And he says, it's not like the ungodly. It's not like chaff that the wind is blowing here and there. Now, as you look at a man like this, any minister can put himself in the position of this man. We can say, blessed is the minister that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the seat of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Quite a number of people will come to your mind as you think about such a man. Moses might come to your mind. Joshua might come to your mind. Nehemiah in particular might come to your mind. He will not walk in the counsel of Sanballat, in the counsel of Tobiah, in the counsel of the people that are seen, come and hide somewhere, because they are after you. Blessed is that man, and blessed is that minister. As you come to the New Testament, you think about Peter, you think about Paul, and blessed is that apostle that will not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. The ungodly would say, have we not told you that you must not preach in this name? Behold, you have saturated, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. And then they will reply, Peter and John, that we're principled people, we're people under the authority of our Savior, and we will not walk in your counsel, we will not stand in the way of sinners, neither are we going to sit in the seat of the scornful. The Pharisees and the Sadducees and all those Herodians, they were the people that scorned and said, you are his disciple, we are the disciples of Moses. But these are ministers, and these are people, and these are men. that are blessed of God indeed. What do we mean by being blessed? They are blessed in God because they have come to God, they have repented of their sins, they are blessed in God. What more? They are blessed in Christ because of what Christ has done on the cross of Calvary. They are blessed. They are blessed in the word. The blessings of the word reach out to them, and the blessings of the word take effect in their lives. They are blessed in ministry. As you see them baptized in the Holy Ghost and propelled by the Holy Ghost, the things they did, you will see that they were blessed in the ministry, and they were blessed in their personal lives too. Blessed is the man. This is the man we're talking about today, and we're making the application of this psalm to the life of the minister. The life of the minister. That's why we're looking at this psalm, and we're talking about the fruitfulness of a truly blessed minister. The fruitfulness of a truly blessed minister. And we're dividing the passage to three parts. Number one, the marks and the blessedness of faithful ministers. The marks and the blessedness of faithful ministers. Point number two, the meditation and the bountifulness of fervent messengers. The messengers who carry the message of the cross and the message of Christ and the message of grace. The meditation of such messengers and the bountifulness of such fervent messengers. But now, point number three, the misery and the burning of fruitless mercenaries. Mercenaries are like, you know, people who are in the place, for who are in the work, in the ministry, in the army in particular, and they, it's like they are working for a foreign mission, a foreign army, but they join, and the Lord calls such people hirelings, hirelings. Whenever there's something that is not according to, you know, their pleasure and their advantage and their gain and their profit, then they run away, and the misery and the burning of such fruitless mercenaries. We're coming to point number one now. In point number one, we're looking at verse one again. In verse 1, it says, blessed is the man. I want you to put yourself there. How can you be in the position of being blessed, in the privilege of being blessed? How can you be a person that is perpetually blessed in every area of your life? Blessed is the minister. Blessed is the man. Blessed is this child of God. And there are things we'll notice about him. Number one, he walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. There are ungodly people. They are quick to offer advice. They are quick to offer counsel. They say this is what to do. They themselves have not been able to put their lives together. They themselves have not been able to live the way they ought to live to please the Lord. But all the same, although their own lives are ungodly, although they are righteous, although they themselves are not sure of the way they are, of the place they are going, yet they are counseling. And you know that there are always counselors all around, ungodly counselors. They want to counsel Moses, they want to counsel Joshua, they want to counsel Nehemiah, they want to counsel Peter and John, they want to counsel Paul the apostle. And it says, a man that is principled, a minister that is saved and sanctified and spirit-filled and spiritual, he will not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, and he will not stand in the way of sinners. Have you noticed those verbs, walketh, standeth, and seated? That is, he makes it a perpetual decision. He will not walk. He never walks in the counsel of the ungodly, and he will not stand with them. He will not stay with them, stand with them, discussing with them, tapping their brain and want. After all, they are sinners. If he is a saint and they are sinners, they have nothing in common. They believe the principles of the world, and this saint of God, this servant of God, believes in the way of the Lord. Nothing brings them together. They will not stand together. He will not stand in the way of the occult man. He will not learn from the occult. He will not learn from the people who have not known the Lord. And he does not sit in the seat of discomfort. The people who scorn the word of God, God and the people who scorn the promises of God, those who scorn the prophecies of the word of God. And he said, that's how the world has always been. Whatever will be, will be. And they are not looking at the word of God and taking in the word of God. A child of God, a man of God, a minister of God, a servant of God, an apostle of the Lord, a pastor of the church of the living God will not sit in the seat of discomfort. I want to show you from that verse the progression of the way of the ungodly and the sinner and discomfort. Number one, they are ungodly. They are ungodly. In their lives, they just don't think about God. They don't factor God in. God is not in their thoughts. They are secular minded. And they are just like that. They are not thinking of what God will say, what God will have me do. Number one, they are just ungodly. God is not in their thoughts. Eventually, now they stand and they are sinners. They transgress. They walk iniquity. They do something. It's not just that they don't put God in their lives or in whatever they are doing. They actually now deliberately, perpetually, and practically, they sin against God. And then, number three, they come to the place now, not only that they are ungodly, not only that they are sinners, but they now scorn. They now scorn. Even when they hear things positive, things practical, they will scorn. Look at that verse again. It says, walketh not, just walking by the road. It's not something permanent yet, but he will not even do that. And what sinners do, and what backsliders do, first of all, they start walking along with those people, with the ungodly, and then they now stand. It's like, don't let us move again. Let's stand here and thrash it out. Let's stand here and pour it into me. Let's stand here and tell me everything you want me to be, everything you want me to do. And eventually they now sit in the seat of discomfort. But now, the minister who is going to be fruitful, the minister who is going to be blessed, what are the marks of such a man, such a minister, and such a servant of God? There are three things I'm going to look at in the life of such a person. Number one, the birth through the blood. You see, without being born again, the Lord Jesus Christ said in John chapter 3 verse 3, it says, verily I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. What we read about in Psalm 1 verse 1, except somebody is born again, he cannot see that kingdom, he cannot taste that kingdom, he cannot live the kingdom life. Look at verse 5. It says in verse 5, Jesus answered, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. We must be born again. How are we born again? Yes, we repent. That's not all. We have faith in Christ. Faith in Christ in what way? In 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 18. 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 18, is talking to us about how we believe and what we believe and what's the sacrifice of Jesus Christ that he has done that makes us to believe and makes us to have the cleansing we ought to have, for as much as you know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers. Now verse 19 tells us, it says, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish, without spot. That's how we come to this new birth, the birth through his blood. And now, what's the behavior? What's the lifestyle? Remember, we're talking about the man, that man in particular. Remember, we're talking about the minister, and that's you. Remember, we're talking about a messenger of the Lord. This is the behavior. Look at Psalm 1 now, verse 1. Blessed is the man. Blessed is that man. Blessed is the minister. Blessed is that minister that walketh not, this is behavior, that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, and he standeth not in the way of sinners. He sitteth not in the seat of discomfort. Why? Look at verse 2. Because it says in verse 2, Psalm 1, verse 2, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. He's a man of the book, a man of the book, and therefore his behavior is based on his book, on the book of God. And look at Joshua chapter 1, reading from verse 8. Joshua chapter 1, reading from verse 8, it says in Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, that the word of the Lord, the law of the Lord, is what is in his heart. It says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you will meditate therein day and night. And it said that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. It says, for then thou, the man of God, thou, the minister of God, thou the servant of God, only then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. It's a man of the book. His behavior, his action, his lifestyle, his ministry, everything he does is based on the words of the book. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 34. Verse 16, Isaiah chapter 34, I'm reading here from verse 16. It says, seek ye out of the book of the Lord, the book of the Lord, a man, a minister, a servant of God, who is going to do according to the will of God, according to the word of God, and is going to minister, and is going to be productive according to the plan and the purpose and the program of God, will be a man of the book. His faith is in the book. His life is in the book. His ministry is the book. His manifestation, the manifestation of what he does, is in the book. Everything, he will not allow the book to ever pass out of his mouth, of his heart, of his hand, because he bases everything he does on the word of the living God. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. We must read before we can meditate. We must read and meditate because before we can apply into our lives. We must read, meditate, apply before we can do and before we can operate by the book and live by the book and act out the book, so that the people who hear us and the people who see us, they know that we're living by the book. In fact, we become epistles for them, we become the Bible for them, we become the word of the Lord for them. Whatever they see us do, they know that that is the word. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. No one of these shall fail, none shall want hamate. For my mouth it has commanded, and his spirit it has gathered them. The Lord Jesus himself tells us how we're to live and what we're to do. It says in Matthew chapter 4, Matthew chapter 4, reading from verse 4, but he answered and said, it is written. Jesus always lived by what is written. He said, you will know that as my Father has taught me, even so say I, even so do I. And when the devil came to tempt him, if the ungodly comes to you, if the sinner comes to you, if the scornful comes to you, and they try to give their counsel, their advice, and they try to tell you this is the way to walk, and they try to tell you this is where to sit, you live by that which is written. It is written. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And where do you get that word that proceeds out of the mouth of God? You get it from the book of God, from the book of God. And so this minister, if you're a real minister, a real servant of God, you are born again through the blood of the Lamb. Not only that, you behave and you act and you live and you minister in a way that is based on the word of God. As we come back to Psalm 1, reading from verse 1. Psalm 1, reading from verse 1, it says, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of discomfort. Blessed is the man. What are the blessings the psalmist himself has outlined? That if you are a child of God, a man of God, a woman of God, and you are a believer in the Lord, and you are a servant and a minister of the gospel, a minister of God, the blessings that are outlined. Blessed is the man. What kind of blessing? And how does he get into that blessing? Look at chapter 2 of the Psalm, Psalm 2 verse 12. In Psalm 2 verse 12, it's telling us, it says, kiss the Son, embrace the Son, love the Son, be attached to the Son, be affectionate to the Son. Accept the love of the Son, that's the Son of God, and then love him back and have faith in him and rely on him. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and ye perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Look at this. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. When he says blessed is the man, who is that man? The man that puts his trust in him. In everything, is trusting the Lord. In a time of ministry, is trusting the Lord. In the time of a pandemic, is trusting the Lord. In the times of worldwide problem, devastation, is trusting the Lord. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Look at Psalm 32, I'm reading from verse 1. In Psalm 32, reading from verse 1, it tells us also how we get into that blessing. The blessedness of this man, the blessedness of that man, the blessedness of the minister. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. And then in verse 2 it says, blessed is the man unto whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no guile. That's how the man becomes blessed, because he has put his faith in the Lord. He has put his trust in the Lord. He puts his confidence in the Lord. And because of that, sins all confessed, and sins all forgiven, and sins all cleansed, because of that, is free and free indeed. And now the Lord will not impute iniquity unto him. It says, what a blessing is the blessing of sanctification. It tells us in Psalm 34. Psalm 34, reading from verses 7 and 8. It's still talking about the blessing of the man. And the blessedness that comes on this man. It says, the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him, and delivereth them. The angel of the Lord encampeth round about the people that will not walk in the way of the ungodly, the people that will not stand in the way of sinners, the people that will not sit in the seat of discomfort. Such a man, because he fears God, the Lord will bless him by delivering him. Look at verse 8. In verse 8 it says, O taste the Lord, O taste and see that the Lord is good. Look at this now. Blessed is the man. That's a blessing. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. It tells us in Psalm 40, reading from verse 4. Psalm 40, reading from verse 4. Here again, it's still describing the blessed man. It says, blessed is the man that maketh the Lord his trust. You see, the emphasis is trusting God. Is having the confidence in God. That's why he doesn't have confidence in the sinner. He doesn't have confidence in the ungodly. He doesn't have confidence in the scornful. His confidence completely is in the Lord. and is not sharing his mind and sharing his thought and sharing his life with the sinner, with the ungodly, and with the scornful. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turned to lies. In verse 5 says, many, O Lord, my God, thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are towards word, they cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. It tells us in Psalm 65, blessed is the man that is blessed, the man that is favored, and the man that is honored by the Lord. It says, blessed is the man, Psalm 65, this is verse 4 now. In verse 4, blessed is the man whom thou choosest, because the Lord sees that he has separated himself from sinners. He wants to live the life that pleases God. He says that, I know this is why God created me, and because this is why God created me, I want to live like he wants me to live. And because of that, God chooses him. He chooses him to be his own child. He chooses him to be his own servant. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, that you may go forth and bear fruit. You see, you're calling, brethren, how that not many mighty, not many wise, not many noble are chosen, but he has chosen the basics of the world, the people that turn to the Lord and that say, I cannot do anything by myself. I am nothing by myself. Without you, I will amount to nothing. Such people, they are chosen by the Lord. Blessed is the man whom thou choosest and causes to approach unto thee, that he may dwell in thy courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of thy house, even thine holy temple. It tells us in Psalm 84, I'm reading from verse 5, Psalm 84 verse 5, blessed is the man whose strength is in thee. You see how the man is blessed? His confidence is in God, and the strength that he has is in the Lord. It says, whose strength is in thee, in whose heart are the ways of them. In verse 6, it says, who passing through the valley of Baca, make it a well, and the rain also filleth the pools. And now he says in verse 7, he says, they go from strength to strength. You see the people who are blessed, you see the people who are favored, you see the people who are honored, the people who are taken out, and the people who are separated to be blessed of the Lord. It says, when God forgives them and God sets them free and God changes their lives and God focuses them on his book, on the word, now because of the trust they have in him and because of the confidence they have in him, the faith they have in him, they go from strength to strength. Remember, blessed is the man, blessed is the minister, blessed is the servant of God. Is going from strength to strength, from salvation to sanctification, from sanctification to spirituality, being filled with the Holy Ghost. And in his life, is not saying, today I'm weak, today I'm down, and today I cannot do anything. The blessing that comes upon such people, the psalmist tells us, part of the blessing is they go from strength to strength. Every one of them in Zion appears before God. It tells us in Psalm 89, reading from verse 15, Psalm 89, verse 15, blessed is the people that know the joyful sound. The joy of the Lord is their strength, and they know the joyful sound. They're never gloomy. They're never sad to the point they're despondent. They're never sad to the point they don't know what to do again, and they throw up their arms and say, what am I going to do? I'm discouraged, I'm downtrodden, I'm whatever, I'm in the valley. No, it says, blessed is the people that know the joyful sound. They shall walk, O Lord, in the light of thy countenance. It tells us in verse 16, it says, in thy name shall they rejoice all the day. That's how they have the joy. That's how the joy of the Lord is their strength. In the day of prosperity, they're happy. In the day of adversity, they have faith in God. In the day when friends are all around, they are rejoicing, Lord. In the days when enemies might be around, they know that they are more than conquerors, and therefore in the name of the Lord shall they rejoice all the day. In thy righteousness shall they be exalted. It says in verse 17, for thou art the glory of their strength. The people, remember, blessed is he, and blessed is the man. This man that is blessed in the glory of the Lord, in the strength of the Lord, he rejoices and he glories. And in thy favor, our horn shall be exalted. It says in verse 18, for the Lord is our defense. That's a blessed man. That's the blessing of the man. The defense of the Lord himself is on him. The angels hover around him. The angels surround him. And because of that, he is the blessed man. The Lord is our defense, and the Holy One of Israel is our king. It says in Psalm 94, reading from verse 12. Psalm 94, reading from verse 12, it says, blessed is the man whom thou chastenest, even when he's corrected, even when he's chastised, because he remains in the presence of God. He does not grumble. He said, Lord, I understand. I need that chastisement, and you're doing that and giving me that. Like a father will correct the son, so you are correcting me, and I rejoice in that. And the chastisement becomes a blessing for them. Blessed is the man whom thou chastenest, O Lord, and teachest him out of thy law. In verse 13, it says in verse 13 that thou mayest give him rest from the days of adversity. That's why it's corrected, until the pit be digged for the wicked. Look at Psalm 106, verse 3. Psalm 106, verse 3. Blessed are they that keep judgment, that keep justice, that keep righteousness, and he that doeth righteousness, underline this in your Bible, at all times. Blessed is the man. He has now been set free. The sins of the past are totally forgiven, and now he doeth righteousness at all times. In the home, righteousness. Outside the home, righteousness. When he's all alone by himself, he doeth righteousness. When he's in the midst of people, he doeth righteousness. When he's in the midst of the people that may not accept, that may not believe, everything he believes, he doeth righteousness. He goes to the village, is for righteousness. It's in the town, in the city, is for righteousness. Anywhere he finds himself, he knows that I am here to stand for God. I am here to represent my Lord. I am here to do whatever will please the Lord. Therefore, he doeth righteousness at all times. In Psalm 119, reading from verse 1, the blessed man, blessed is the man. Who are those that are blessed? It says, blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. They will not walk in the way of sinners. They will not stand in the seat, in the way of the sinners and the ungodly. They will not sit in the seat of the scornful, but blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. In verse 2, it says, blessed are they that keep his testimonies, and that seek him with the whole heart. Whatever he does in the way of the Lord, whatever he does in the ministry, whatever he does in the service of the Lord, he brings his soul strength, his soul heart, his soul mind, his own knowledge, his own might and power into it. He seeks the Lord, and he serves the Lord with his whole heart. In verse 3, it says, in verse 3, they also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. He's a blessed man indeed. And in Psalm 128, Psalm 128, reading from verse 1, Blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord. All the time is controlled by the fear of God. It's not controlled by the fear of man. It's not controlled about the fear of unbelievers, of sinners, of the ungodly, of discomfort. No, not at all. All the time is saying, how will God appreciate this? How will God look at this? How will God reward this? How will God evaluate this? Because that man feareth the Lord all the time. Blessed is everyone that feareth the Lord and walketh in his ways. Look at the blessing, verse 2 here. In verse 2 it says, thou shalt eat the labor of thine hands. Happy shalt thou be. Blessed shalt thou be, favored shalt thou be, provided for shalt thou be, happy, glad shalt thou be, and it shall be well with thee. That's the man, that's the man, that's the minister, that's the child of God, that's the minister of God, the marks and the blessedness of faithful ministers. We are coming to point number 2 now. In point number 2, it's telling us about the meditation of such a minister and the bountifulness of such a messenger. The meditation and the bountifulness of fervent messengers. Fervent messengers. And look at Psalm 1, reading from verses 2 and 3. Psalm 1. Verses 2 and 3. His delight is in the law of the Lord. His delight is joy. It's in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. You know, the mind is always meditating on something. The mind might be meditating on, you know, what happened yesterday, what happened last week, what happened another time. And it is in the direction of the meditating of your mind, the meditation of your mind, that your life will go. But if you delight in the law of the Lord, and in that law you are meditating day and night, look at what the result will be. In verse 3, it says, in verse 3, and it shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters. That minister, remember, that man, remember, who is blessed of the Lord, who is meditating on the word of the Lord, and who is doing according to the word of the Lord, who is doing righteousness by faith, righteousness by grace, righteousness by the enabling power of the Lord at all times, such a person shall be like a tree that is planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth its fruit in its season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Why? Because he does whatever he does with all his heart. Whatsoever your hand finds to do, do it with all thy might and all thy strength, for there is no profit and there is nothing else you can do in the grave after you have died. Therefore he says, whatever I can do today, whatever I can do for the Lord, whatever I can do for the church of the living God, whatever I can do for the believer, whatever I can do to make progress in the things of the Lord, whatever he doeth shall prosper, because he doeth it by faith. Whatever he does by faith shall prosper, because he does it by the word, by the direction, by the leading of the word of God. Whatever he doeth shall prosper, because he does it for the expansion of the kingdom of God. God has to support that. God has to make that to prosper. Whatever he doeth shall prosper, because he doeth it selflessly, without any selfishness at all. His mind is there, his heart is there, his wisdom is there, his focus is there, and his passion is there. Whatsoever he doeth with all his heart for God, for the expansion of the kingdom, and for the good of other people, shall prosper. As I look at this man, the meditating man, who is blessed bountifully, and who is a fervent messenger of the Lord. Now look at this. Number one, he meditates on the word of God. Meditation on the word. It says in verse 2, in his law shall he delighteth, but his delight is in the law of of the Lord, and because his delight is the law of the Lord, in that law and in that word does he meditate day and night. In that law, in that word of God, in that promise of God, in that proclamation of God, in the prophecies of the word, in everything the Lord has revealed, he meditates day and night. He does not meditate on whatever bad news or even good news is hearing in the city, in the town, on the road, everywhere. His meditation is always on the word of the Lord. He meditates on the word. The meditation on the word. Look at Joshua. Joshua chapter 1, reading from verse 8. It says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but you will meditate. It says, thou shalt meditate therein, that is in that book of the law, day and night, and that thou mayest observe, that thou mayest observe. The process and the purpose of meditation is so that you will do the word of the Lord, that thou mayest do according to all that is written therein. For then, because you meditate on the word, for then shalt thou make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 15, the meditation on the word of God, the concentration on the word of God. 1 Timothy chapter 4, reading from verse 15, meditate upon these things. Everything we're hearing, meditate upon these things. The way of the blessed man, meditate on that. And the word that is given to the blessed man, meditate on that. The doctrines of the word of God, given unto us as ministers, meditate on that. The way of sinners and the destination of sinners, meditate on that. And the way of the righteous, where the righteous will spend eternity, meditate on that. And the reward we're going to have on the final day, meditate on that. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. And then it says in verse 16, in verse 16 is telling us, take heed unto thyself and to the doctrine. That's part of what we are to meditate on. If the people don't know the doctrine of the word of God, of salvation, of righteousness, of holiness, and they don't have chance to take that in and to meditate on that and to pray on that and to live by that, how are they going to get to heaven? If they don't get to heaven, what's the result of your ministry? And so yourself, you take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. It tells us what's the motivation of the work of this man. We're coming back to Psalm 1 and we're looking at verse 3. What motivates him? The motivation for the work. What's your motivation? The motivation of the blessed man. The motivation of the blessed minister. The motivation of the productive messenger of the Lord. What's the motivation? Look at that verse 3 of Psalm 1. It says, and ye shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither. His leaf also shall not wither. And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. What motivates him? The very fact that God has counted him worthy. And the very fact that God is going to make him fruitful and is going to make him fresh at all season, that motivates him. God counts me worthy. God counts me faithful, and God counts me usable. And that motivation keeps him going. The privilege you have in Christ, the privilege you have in the Lord, that keeps you motivated. Look at Psalm 8, reading from verse 4. You are motivated. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? Verse 5, it says, for thou hast made him a little lower than angels. That motivates him. It says, the creation you have made, And the way you have crowned the man, and you have crowned the minister, and the privilege you have given him, and his comparison, not too far from the angels, you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. He says that should motivate any man. When God has put you in a position, and he has given you a work to do that angels cannot do. He has given you an assignment that angels cannot carry out. And he makes the destiny of people, eternal welfare of people, he makes that dependent on what you do that should motivate you. That God has given you a work that other people cannot do. And there's no way that even angels can do this, for thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. In verse 6, it says, in verse 6, and thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hand. Shouldn't that motivate us, that God lifted up man, that God raised up man, that God appointed man, that God assigned a man, and he makes him to have dominion, not over your work, but over his own work, the work of his hand. And thou hast put all things under his feet. I think if anything should motivate us, that should motivate every one of us. In Psalm 71, reading from verse 17. Psalm 71, reading from verse 17. O God, thou hast taught me from my youth that God will kind of single you out, that God will select you and sit you down and teach you his mind and teach you his message and teach you his word. And God will do that continually, that God brings you into his own school and he teaches you and he enlightens you and he tells you the way you should go and the things you should do. That should be a great motivation. That's exactly what he did to the Lord Jesus Christ. He sent him to this world, and Jesus said, I do all things as my Father has taught me. That the Father, Heavenly Father, will do the same thing for you and send the Holy Ghost, that the Holy Ghost will teach you. What a great privilege. That should motivate us, and that should make us to say, if I'm so privileged, I'm going to be the blessed man. I have the book of God, and I have the blessing of God, and I have the Spirit of God leading me into all truth. For, O God, thou hast taught me from my youth, and hitherto have I declared thy wondrous works. It tells us in verse 18, now also, when I'm old and gray-headed, O God, thou forsake me not. Yes, I will not forsake you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will be with you until the end. And it says, until I have showed thy strength unto this generation, and thy power to everyone that is to come. In verse 19, it says, thy righteousness also, O God, is very high. Who has done great things? Doesn't that motivate you? He's doing great things. He has done great things, and he'll continue to do great things. That when you minister his word and you declare his might to the people, he will do great things. That when you pray for people and when you ask him for any blessing upon the people, he will do great things. That what he has done with men, with ministers in years, generations gone by, he will do through you as well. That should be a great motivation for you and for me. Who has done great things, O God, who is like unto thee? In Psalm 73, verse 24. Psalm 73, verse 24, thou shalt guide me with thy counsel. That's motivation. When I'm sure the Lord will guide me, when I'm sure there's no problem that will not have a solution, when I'm sure that whatever it is, the Lord himself, by his Spirit, will guide me. He has sent his Holy Ghost that will guide us into all truth. He'll guide us into all solution. He has given all the equipment we would need so that we will serve him with proper divine spiritual solution, solution-generating message that he will give us. Because of that guidance, we should be well motivated. Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me to glory. That, you know, glory comes at the end of our service, at the end of our serving the Lord. That should be a great motivation for us. In verse 25, verse 25 says, whom have I in heaven but thee? Whom have I in heaven but thee? The assurance of heaven. That's good motivation. And the fact that God is there waiting for us and is planning the best for us here on earth, that's a great motivation. And there is none upon the earth that I desire besides thee. In verse 26, it says, my flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart and is my portion forever. Isn't that a great motivation? Whatever the world may withdraw and whatever the world may not give, it says, you are my portion forever. In verse 27, for lo, they that are far from thee shall perish. Thou hast destroyed all them that go a warring from thee. Verse 28 says, but it is good for me to draw near to God. There's a lot to have, there's a lot to get, there's a lot to benefit. The strength for the journey, and the strength for the way, and the strength for the ministry. There's a lot for us when we draw near unto God. It is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all thy works. Now, we're seeing the meditation of the fervent messenger. We're seeing the motivation for the work. Now, the multiplication of the workers, the multiplication of the workers. We're so motivated, and then we realize that the work is so much, we cannot handle the work all alone by ourselves. So we train others, so we develop others, so we encourage others, so we enlist others, so we engage others to go along with us. And we're multiplying the workers. Actually, it says in Psalm 68, verse 11. Psalm 68, verse 11, it says, the Lord gave the word. He's giving the word of salvation. He's giving the word of his grace. He's giving the word of eternal life. The Lord gave the word, and great was the company of those that published it. Great was the company of those that published it, those people that join in publishing the word, in proclaiming the word, in preaching the word, in spreading the word of the gospel. How did they know about the word? Because you told them. How did they learn about the word? Because you taught them. How did they have the motivation and the passion? Because you put the zeal in them and the fire in them. Because you engage them. And because you tell them, let us go along and preach the word of the gospel. The Lord gave the word, and he gave it to you, and you gave it to them, and you spread it to them, and you teach them, and you motivate them, and you put the zeal, the passion, and the fire in them. So great was the company of those that published it. Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 4. Acts chapter 8, reading from verse 4. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. How did they come to that? The apostles had given them the word, had taught them the word. Because you see, all those people that were converted on the day of Pentecost, and the day and the people that were converted after, they continued in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread, and in prayers from house to house, because they have been trained. Because they had been taught, because they had been developed, because they had been engaged, they had been enlisted in the work of the Lord as they were scattered abroad. Now, this is the only thing they could do, and they did it with all their strength, they did it with all their energy, they did it with all their passion. It says, therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Can we say that about the workers that pass through you. Can we say that about the members of the church that passed through your ministry? That you got the word, you passed it on to them. You got the doctrine, you passed it on to them. You got the zeal, you passed it on to them. You got the passion and the fire, and you passed it on to them. And now, anywhere they are in their homes, anywhere they are in the villages, anywhere they are, where the circumstances of life have scattered them abroad to, and all the tools they can use, their telephone and other things, therefore now they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. And this is what must continue. We're told in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 2, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses. What are those things? The word of salvation. What are those things? The word of holiness. What are those things? The word of evangelism. What are those things? The word of the doctrines of the word of God. What are those things? The words that make us ready for the coming of the Lord. And the things that thou hast said of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men. Don't subtract from the word. The same commit thou to faithful men. Don't add to the word. The same commit to faithful men. Don't modify the word. The same commit to faithful men. And don't waste your life on those who are not, who are not faithful, who are not stable, and who will not abide in the word and abide in Christ. First of all, make them abide. Make them faithful to the word. And when you see that the grace of God has come to them, they are saved, they are sanctified, they are stabilized, they are stable, they are established, and they are steadfast, and they are now ready to be faithful, then you commit the work into their hands, and you commit the ministry into their hands. You will not stop. You keep on ministering. You keep on giving out the word while you are training those people, engaging those people, and the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. I pray God will give us the grace, and God will give us all that we need to do, so that through you and through me, we'll keep on helping the people to be who they ought to be. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 11. Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11 is talking about the people God himself through Jesus Christ has raised up, and he gave them, he gave some apostles, and he gave some prophets, and he gave some evangelists, and he gave some pastors and teachers. But why? Why? What's the work? What's the ministry of those apostles? What's the ministry of those prophets? The proclaimers of the word coming out of the mouth of the Lord. What's the ministry of those evangelists and those pastors and teachers? You see, they're to go out and plant churches. That's right. They're to go out and declare the word and the mind of Christ. That's right. They are to proclaim the prophecies of the word as prophets, and they are to take those prophecies, explain them, analyze them, and show the people that we are waiting for the coming of the Lord. And that coming of the Lord is imminent. From all that is happening now, you speak like a prophet. It is about to happen, the rapture and the coming of the Lord. That's what they are to do. Who are the evangelists? To say that the evangelists are people that go beyond their circle, beyond their community, and they are proclaiming the word and preaching the word, and sinners are coming into the kingdom. The pastors and teachers, they're teaching the people of God in church services, and they are ministering to them, shepherding them and taking care of them, protecting them and preserving them in the kingdom. That's true, that's true. But you know, there's more. If you look at verse 12, verse 12 says, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, the teachers, they are to perfect the saints, they are to prepare the saints, they are to mature the saints, they are to develop the saints for the work of the ministry. for the work of the ministry. The blessed minister is the one that is not only producing fruit by himself, it's the one that is not only having his leaves green, ever green by himself, it's the one that is not only growing by himself, it's growing others, it's developing others, it's perfecting others, it's maturing others for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, that those workers will now take part in the edification of the body of Christ. But how long are we going to do that? Haven't we done enough training of workers and now we can stop? Haven't we done enough development of our leaders and now we can stop? Look at verse 13. In verse 13 it says, until we all come in the unity of the faith. It says the training will go on, the developing will go on, the multiplication of workers will go on until we all come, until all the members come in, until all the members also are trained to evangelize, are trained to bear fruit, we're multiplying them. And as long as there's still a member there, there's still a child of God there who is not involved, you should be motivated and you should so meditate on the assignment God has given us that we multiply. And you take those people, those members, and you help them until we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto a matured man, unto a productive man, unto a stabilized man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You know what that is saying? It's saying that you yourself should not stop developing yourself. You should not stop educating yourself, enlightening yourself. You should not stop growing yourself. You should not stop maturing until you come to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And the people were leading, and the pastors were helping, and the ministers were grooming, and the members were developing. We will not stop until everyone, myself, yourself, and them, everyone will come to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. We're coming to point number three now. And we're reading from Psalm 1, reading from verse 4. The mystery and burning of fruitless mercenaries. It tells us, it says in verse 4, Psalm 1, verse 4, but the ungodly are not so. It says, the ungodly are not like the blessed man. The ungodly are not like the meditating ministers. The ungodly are not like the productive ministers. It says, not so the ungodly, not so the ungodly. The ungodly are not so, but they are like chaff which the wind drives away. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. It says in verse 5, therefore the chaff, therefore the ungodly, therefore those sinners, therefore those scoffers, therefore those unrighteous people, therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. In verse 6 it says, for the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. He knoweth the way. Why? Because he is the one that is the way. And it's that way that the righteous is following. It's the one that mapped out the way. The way, the narrow way that leads to life eternal. And the righteous people, they came through the gate of repentance and faith in Christ. And they are walking in that way. It's the way of God himself. And he knows that this man, before he became righteous, this man, this woman, and this minister, before he became righteous, he came to that way of the Lord. So the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous. But the way of the ungodly shall perish. What does that mean? The way of the drunkard shall perish, and the way of the sinner, the way of the people that transgress, the way that the principles they have laid down and what they have taught other people, go this way, go this way. And it's the way of the ungodly, it's the way of the unrighteous, it's the way of the unstable, of the chaff that the wind is blowing away. It says the way of the ungodly shall perish. Now these are about the people that on their own, what they do is not according to the will of God, they'll have misery and they'll have burning on the final day. Look at Hebrews chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 8. Hebrews chapter 6, we're reading from verse 8. It says, but that which beareth thorns and briars is rejected. Those who do not have the real value and the real worth of the wheat and of the righteous people of God, their thorns and their briars, it says they'll be rejected, and it's nigh unto cursing, whose end is to be burnt. The end is to be burnt. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, it tells us about these people, for the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. The judgment will come on the final day, when God will look at the works of every man. And when God will look at the ministries and ministration of every man, when God will look at the influence and the impact of every man, when God will look at the work we have done here on earth, it says that time of judgment will come. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us apostles, at us ministers, at us who are even doing the work the way God has mapped it out, if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? Who are those that obey not the gospel of God? Doesn't mean that they are not religious. They are religious, but they are mercenaries. They are hirelings. They are not a people that have the interest of Christ and the interest of the church and the interest of even the sinners at heart. Their eternal welfare is not their concern. Their eternal destiny is not their concern. They are just there for whatever they can get. We call them mercenaries. Mercenaries, look at Hosea chapter 10, verse 1. Hosea chapter 10, verse 1. And see what the way the Lord describes them. And see the way that the Lord describes these mercenaries. It says in verse 1, Israel is an empty vine, and bringeth forth fruit unto himself. It shall bring forth fruit unto God. It shall bring converts unto God. It shall bring disciples unto God. It shall bring followers unto Christ. But the mercenaries, the hirelings, the false prophets, and the people that have false motive, it says they are empty vines, and they bring forth fruit unto themselves. In Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 21, Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 21, here Paul the apostle speaks about them, for all seek their own. They seek their advantage, and they seek their own profit, and they seek their own gain, and they seek their own profit. It says, for all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Those are the mercenaries. Those are the hirelings, and their need for what they can get, you know, the offering that can come and come to them, the gain that can come and come to them, the women that can be in the fellowship and be for them, and all the various things of the flesh, they think they can gain out of the ministry. It says, because it's just for them, they are not working for the Lord, they are working for themselves. In Isaiah chapter 56, reading from verse 11, Isaiah chapter 56, verse 11. Look at the latter part of that. It says, they all look to their own way. They all look to their own way, everyone for his gain from his quarter. Those are the mercenaries. Those are the people that bear fruit to themselves. Everything they do is to get the disciples for themselves, the members of their church for themselves, their money for themselves, their talent for themselves, is to build them up, is to prop them up, is to exalt them, is to elevate them. They are mercenaries, and they are not working for God. And Second Peter chapter 2 verse 3 talks about them. Second Peter chapter 2, verse 3. And through covetousness shall they with feigned words, pretending words, hypocritical words, make merchandise of you. They make merchandise of members of the church. They make merchandise of members of their local assembly, of their ministry. They have that so that, you know, money comes from there, money comes from there. And whatever they will preach, it will be to motivate the people to give more and to motivate the people to, you know, get into that business and then come and give us this. They don't see the people totally belonging to God. They don't see the people totally serving the Lord. They don't see the people giving themselves entirely, completely, sacrificially unto the Lord. All they want to do is to so emphasize their error, is to so emphasize all the principles and whatever they emphasize, so that the people will be committed to them and they want the people to serve them. Those are mercenaries. They are not people that want the goodness of the people, the goodness of the members, and the goodness of the people of God. It says that they will make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. I pray none of us will be like that in Jesus' name. Look at verse 18 of that Second Peter chapter 2, and I'm reading there from verse 15. It says, which are forsaking the right way, like Balaam, are forsaking the right way. They are not preaching the right way of the Lord and the gospel of the Lord. All they want is to have money from the people, which are forsaking the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Bozor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. They love the wages of unrighteousness. They love the wages of unrighteousness. We need to examine ourselves. Are we ministers who are devoted to the work of the Lord, for the purpose of the Lord, for the plan of the Lord, and we have the goodness of the people at heart, that they will be saved, that they remain saved, that they remain steadfast, and they remain holy and ready for the coming of the Lord? Or are we mercenaries that are bringing fruit to ourselves? Are we mercenaries and hirelings that are seeking our own gain, our own profit, and not the profit of the people? What are the manners of these mercenaries? The chaff that the wind driveth away. What are their manners? Look at 2 Kings chapter 18, reading from verse 33. 2 Kings chapter 18, verse 33. They feared the Lord. That's what they say. That's what brought them to the ministry, and served their own gods, gods of gold, gods of silver, gods of prosperity, gods of money, gods of the flesh, gods of personal ambition. It says they feared God and served their own gods after the manner of the nations whom they carried away from thence. In verse 34, it says, unto this day they do after their former manner. That means there's no real conversion. There's some people who are into the ministry, but there's no conversion. There are people who are into the service of God, in the sanctuary of God, and yet there is no conversion, there is no change. And it says, unto this day, they do after their former manners. They fear not the Lord, neither do they after their statutes, nor or after their ordinances, or after the law and the commandment which the law commanded the children of Jacob, whom he named Israel. It tells us in verse 40 about these people. In verse 40, it says, howbeit they did not hearken, but they did after their former manner. That's their manners. They did after their former manner. It tells us in Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 21. Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 21. It says, I spake unto thee in thy prosperity, but thou says, I will not hear. Those are mercenaries, and that's their manner. When the Lord talks to them, when the word of God comes to them, it says, I spoke to you in the day of your prosperity, but you say, I will not hear. This has been thy manner from thy youth, that thou obeyest not my voice. Do you know, ministers who might preach, they might even preach sound doctrine, and they might preach the word of God straight, and they might preach the word of holiness and righteousness, and yet they do not obey the word of God. In verse 22, it says in verse 22, the wind shall eat up all thy pastors. Those are the chaff, the wind shall eat up all those pastors, and thy lover shall go into captivity. Surely then shall thou be ashamed and confounded for all thy wickedness. It says in Ezekiel chapter 11 verse 12, Ezekiel chapter 11 verse 12, and ye shall know that I am the Lord, for we have not walked in my statutes. You know, if God is talking to a minister, if God is talking to one of his servants, if God is talking to you, and God will say, as a minister, as my servant, as the one that is preaching the word of God, in your lifestyle, in your ministry, in everything you're doing, you have not walked in my statutes. That's a serious confrontation, and that's a serious allegation. And then he says, neither executed my judgments, but have done after the manners of the heathen that are found round about you. That's a serious, serious sin. And the Lord wants us to behave not like the people of the world, but to behave as the children of God. In Psalm 106 verse 35, Psalm 106 verse 35, it tells us there, in Psalm 106 verse 35, the manner of the child of God, the manner of the minister of the gospel, the manner that we ought to have. But how are we going to have that manner? There's something for us to avoid. It says, but they were mingled among the heathen and learned their works. The people who mingle among unbelievers, there are unbelieving preachers, there are sinful preachers, there are ungodly preachers, there are denominational preachers, and if we mingle with them, we learn their ways, we learn their works, and we act like they act, and we preach like they preach, and we have the same motive and the same passion and the same purpose they have, we will be like chaff to be driven away from the kingdom eventually. And I pray that will not happen to any of us in Jesus' name. We've seen the mercenaries, we've seen their manners. What's their mystery? What's their mystery? Let's look at that Psalm 1, verse 4 again. Psalm 1, verse 4. It says, the ungodly are not so. But that means the ungodly, they are not righteous. The ungodly do not avoid the way of sinners. The ungodly do not avoid the counsel of the ungodly. The ungodly do not avoid the siege of discomfort. The ungodly, they do not meditate upon the word of the book. The ungodly do not serve, they do not work, they do not act according to the word of God. The ungodly do not practice, they do not do the things that God wants done. That's why it says in the original, not so the ungodly. The ungodly are not so. But they are like chaff. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. Let's look at their mystery. What will happen to the chaff on the final day? We're looking at Matthew chapter 3. Matthew chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 12. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 12, he's talking about the chaff and about what the Lord said will happen to the chaff on the final day. The people that are not saved by their ministers, they are not sanctified by their ministers, they are not righteous by their ministers, they are not godly by their ministers, and they are not sanctified and holy by their ministers, they are not focused on the word by their ministers, they are not doing the work like God wants it done by their ministers, and the Lord calls them chaff. He calls them ungodly. He calls them sinners. He calls them transgressors. And he calls them scoffers and scorners. He says, whose fan is in his son? This is Matthew chapter 3, verse 12. Whose fan is in his son? And he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather the wheat into the garner. And he shall burn up, look at this, he shall burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And when it says burn up, it's not like they annihilated. It's not like they are burnt and then they are forgotten. Unquenchable fire. They keep on burning and burning and burning. The ungodly, the sinner, and the scoffer, and the scorner, and the mercenaries, and the hirelings, and the people that do not have the grace of God, and they're preaching false doctrine deliberately to gain and to have something for themselves. They'll be like chaff that will be burnt with unquenchable fire on the final day. It tells us in Matthew chapter 8, verse 12, Matthew chapter 8, verse 12, it says, but the children of the kingdom shall be cast out. The people who normally should have belonged to the kingdom, claiming to be sons and daughters of Abraham and servants of God, like Abraham was, friends of God, like Abraham was, but because they didn't follow after the way of the Lord, the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness, and there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Weeping and gnashing of teeth. It says in Matthew chapter 25 verse 30. Matthew chapter 25, reading from verse 30. And cast ye the unprofitable servant. Look at that. Servant, but not profitable for the kingdom. Servant, but not profitable to even his own soul. Servant, but not profitable to the field of the master, to do the evangelism and to do it and bring sheaves into the kingdom. Not profitable for the believers to help them, encourage them, enlighten them, engage them, and put them into profitable service. They heed their talent, they heed their ability, and they heed their strength and the grace that they should have to give the right thing to the people of God. They did not. And it says, cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jude tells us in Jude chapter 1. Jude chapter 1, reading from verse 6. And the angel which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. Is saying that the chaff who are blown away by the whirlwind of the judgment of God, they'll get into the judgment of the great day. In verse 7, it says in verse 7, even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. That's the mystery of the chaff, the burning and the punishment, eternal punishment for those who are not in the Lord, and yet they are trying to carry on a kind of ministry. It says in verse 13 of that same Jude chapter 1, reaching waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame, wandering stars, to whom is reserved, look at this, the blackness of darkness forever. The blackness of darkness forever. What are we to do? Come back to Psalm 1. In Psalm 1, it tells us how we're to make our lives to be blessed, how we're to make our lives to be enriched by the Lord, how we're to make our ministries to be blessed. In Psalm 1, I'm looking at verse 1. In Psalm 1, looking at verse 1, it says, blessed is the man. Make up your mind to be the man. Make up your mind to be the minister. Make up your mind to be the servant of God that is blessed in the day day and blessed in the night, that is blessed in ministry and blessed in the family. Make yourself the man, the woman, the minister, the servant of God that is blessed, that God will look at and he will say, you have the qualification and you have the attribute of being blessed by the Lord. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. The ungodly will try to counsel you. Unbelievers will try to counsel. The religious people will try to counsel you, but you will not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. You will not stand in the way of sinners. That means you will not stand in the way with sinners. You will not stand in their way. And then as they are coming, you invite them, sinner. What do you think about what I'm doing? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? You are not getting the counsel. You are not getting the advice. And you are not getting the admonition. You are not getting anything from those sinners. You separate yourself. You set yourself apart. And you are not going to stand in the way of those sinners, nor seated in the seat of discomfort. In verse 2, this is what you are to be, and this is what you are to do, but to make your delight to be in the law of the Lord. Be a man of the book, a minister of the book. Be a child of God that goes to the word of God, and you abide in that word, in your personal life, in that word, in your ministry, in that word, in your ministration, it's in that word. Your delight and your joy and your will and everything about you is the delight and the joy in the word of God. And in that, Lord, do you meditate day and night. And this is the assurance the Lord himself is giving you. The Lord is saying in verse 3, you will be like the tree that is planted. You'll not be, you know, planted and uprooted, because, you know, every plant the Heavenly Father has not planted will be rooted out, will be rooted off, will be taken away. But you are planted. You are planted by the rivers of water. There's the river of the grace of God. You are planted there. There's the river of the love of God. You are planted there. There's the river of the mercy of God. You are planted there. And you do not shift away from that anytime. Planted by the rivers of waters, you'll be bringing forth fruit. Monday, you bring forth fruit. Tuesday, you bring forth fruit. All the other 3 days, you are bringing forth fruit. As you go in evangelism, as you go ministry to the people of God, you are bringing forth fruit every time in your season. Dry season, you are still bringing forth fruit. Rainy season, you are bringing forth fruit. The season of pandemic, you are bringing up forth fruit. And the season when the lockdown is over, anytime, every time in your life, you have the privilege of bringing forth fruit every time. And your leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever you do, evangelist, whatsoever you do, pastor, whatsoever you do, teacher, whatsoever you do, apostle, pastor, prophet, whatsoever you do, servant of God, whatsoever you do for the kingdom of God, in the kingdom of God, for the progress extension of the kingdom of God, whatsoever you do, you will prosper. I will prosper. The work of God will prosper in my hand. The work of God will prosper in your hand in Jesus' name. Let's take that to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, I want to be the man. I want to be the minister. I want to be the servant of God. I want to be the man. I want to be the woman that will prosper in the work of the Lord. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Are you the man? Are you the man, the woman that is blood bought? You're born again by the blood of the Lamb. Are you the man that is Bible-based? The word of God is the number one thing in your life. Are you the man? Are you the woman that everything you do is according to the word of the Lord? What are the marks of your life? Do you have the marks of a real minister of God? The minister that is helping people to know the Lord. The minister helping people to love the Lord. The minister making people to concentrate on the word and live by the word and have experiences in the word, have experiences by the word. Tell the Lord that the grace of God will come more into your life. Tell the Lord that the goodness of God will come more in your life, that there will be transformation, transfiguration in your life, in your mind, in your soul, that you will do the work with new strength. strength. You'll do the work with new focus. You'll do the work with new passion and with new zeal. And then the blessing of the Lord, the blessedness of salvation and the blessedness of sanctification and the blessedness of being planted by the rivers of water will be in your life. Tell the Lord that the Lord himself will help you, and that the habit of meditating upon the word will be established in you. You'll not be meditating on, you know, what people think and what people say and what people did and what people have not done. You'll not be meditating on this and that, but on the word of God. You meditate upon the promise of God. You meditate upon the prophecies of the word. You meditate upon the precepts of the word. You meditate upon the promises the Lord has given you. And as you meditate on that, when you pray, your meditation will affect your prayer. When you minister, your meditation will affect your ministry. And when you plant the seed of the word of God in the lives of people, your meditation will affect everything. And then you will be motivated to keep on serving. You know, if you are not motivated, if you are discouraged, if you are down, and if you are despondent, it's because you are meditating on the wrong thing. When you meditate on the word of God, you'll be motivated to do the work of God more and more, and then you'll be looking for how to multiply the workers. You'll not be chaff that is blown here and there. You'll not be like a hireling that is not interested, and you will not be like, you know, your manners of the past is what is still there, and you will not have the mystery now. You'll not have the mystery also in eternity, but the goodness of God will be upon your life. Tell the Lord to renew your strength. Tell the Lord to renew your joy. Tell the Lord to renew your fervency. Tell the Lord to renew you within, without, and in every area. And this work will prosper in your hand. All the grace you need, the Lord will grant unto you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the exposition, the explanation, the exhortation you have given us in this psalm. And we're asking, O Lord, all the good things we have revealed, all the good things you have taught us in this psalm will be transferred into every life and into the ministry of every minister in Jesus' name. The way of the sinner, the way of the ungodly, the way of the scorner, and the people who are chaff, and the people who are being blown here and there unstable. Take all that away from every one of us in Jesus' name. Help us, Lord, to be planted by the rivers of water. Help us, Lord, to be planted in your grace, in your love, in your mercy, in your spirit, and abide in your word all the days of our life, that we will bear fruit. Even our appearance and leave will be fresh every time. And whatsoever we do for the expansion of the kingdom, whatsoever we do for the progress of the kingdom, whatsoever we do for the propagation of the gospel will prosper, and every one of us will be rewarded in this life and in the life to come, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.